Welcome to Talks at Google. I'm delighted to introduce today's speaker, our comedy guru, Sean Hardie. Enjoy.
Thanks. I'll tell you just a little bit about myself because it may help. I started life as a journalist with the BBC in London, worked on Panorama and programmes like that. And then I moved into comedy rather bizarrely and worked on a number of programmes across the channel like Not the 9 O'Clock News and Spitting Image and Rory Bremner. And then I gave that up and I basically write plays and things now. So I do a bit of everything. I'm not going to talk that long. No one ever said that a wedding speech was too long and you'll be out in good time, and I don't mind if people walk out. And I want to talk about the imagination, because I think the imagination is a wonderful thing and is a fun thing, and it's kind of been marginalized in the way we live and work these days. And I wanted to start by I'm going to ask you to close your eyes an awful lot in this, not just so you don't have to see me, but because the imagination works wonderfully with your eyes closed. And just for a moment, could everyone close their eyes and imagine they're somewhere? It doesn't matter where, it could be anywhere. It could be in the Sahara, it could be locked in the toilet, wherever you are. Just imagine where you are. And just be there and imagine you're there. And then imagine you're a tortoise. Everyone a tortoise in wherever they happen to be. And another tortoise comes in and says, there's a problem. And open your eyes again. Now, what you could do with the imagination the whole time is just think of a situation. Any of you could take that story and run with it. You know, you've got two people in a place, and because it's an animal, you're not kind of self-conscious about it. There's this terrible thing called perceptual defense, which cuts out the brain from going anywhere because they think they might do something embarrassing or people would think they were stupid and so on. If you do it with animals, you could do it. When next time you're stuck on the dart, just be an animal and go somewhere. My own roots to the imagination and to fiction and to comedy and so on began really when I was working as a journalist. And I increasingly found that although I was a very bad journalist because I didn't know how to make cold calls, but that aside, you're boxed in because you have to deal with facts all the time, which is not the same as dealing with the truth. And there was a particular instance where I was working for BBC Panorama in the north in the 1970s at the height of the Troubles. And we were filming in a town which has had a terrible time with bombings and terrible unemployment. And a fellow came up to me and pinned me against the wall. It was quite funny. We were meant to be filming the man who was the spokesman for the Unemployed Action Committee, but he was at work. So we were waiting. And this guy told me this story about his son. And essentially said there's been a terrible miscarriage of justice. My son has been sent down for doing something he didn't do. He didn't set off that bomb. And he told me the story. And the way he told the story, it was clear there'd been a miscarriage of justice. And I was going back to London, so I handed it on to a producer friend of mine in Belfast who then made a documentary about this case, which then went on to become a play about this miscarriage of justice. But the true story of the miscarriage of justice is that there was a kid in this town. I've never heard anyone say a good word about him. He was a tearaway. He was up to all kinds of nonsense and a loudmouth. And he was doing low-key jobs for the IRA, just running messages and keeping lookout and all the rest of it. And he'd become an embarrassment to the IRA, to the provisionals, because he was a loudmouth and was shouting his mouth off. And around that time, there was a new RUC superintendent had come into town, and there'd been a bomb in the Union Hall there, and he needed a conviction. The IRA, the provisionals, wanted to get rid of this kid. The RUC wanted a conviction. So the RUC and the provisionals stitched this kid up and sent him down. It's a miscarriage of justice. He'd done 1,000 other things. He didn't do this bomb. And I found that a very interesting story because it says an awful lot about the reality of what happens in paramilitary situations, how much the security forces have in common with the people they're meant to be fighting because they're both in the same business and so on. I couldn't do that as a documentary, and I couldn't do it because I could never prove any of it. And yet, if you could find a way of telling that story which had all the ingredients in it and which was credible, then it would reveal an aspect of what was going on in the North which you wouldn't otherwise get. And around that time, I decided I wanted to move out of doing journalism and that you could find a different kind of truth through doing fiction and through doing comedy and all the rest of it. And so I then went and did television comedy and satire for a while. And then I started writing books. And now I do more or less anything I get paid for. But I write plays mostly these days. And that's why I got very interested in the imagination. Because if you want to tell stories, the imagination is this wonderful resource that's in there. I think it's got very marginalized for various reasons now, because we are so, there's a difference between data and wisdom, you know, which I'm sure you've heard about, is that we don't allow ourselves to think in that kind of way, or we think we don't need to think in that kind of way. I'm not technophobe at all. I bought my first Apple Mac in 1984, before most of you were born. I wish I still had it. And there's a load of things I use technology for, and that technology does wonderfully, and there are things that technology doesn't do. And I use technology a lot for a lot of things, and there's a lot of things I don't use technology for. Interestingly, when I'm writing, if I get stuck, I always go longhand. I always go pen and paper. And for some reason, it frees you up in a way where you're not taking it seriously. The things that I think that, by and large, the digital age finds difficulty coping with are the kind of the muddle areas. And emotions and contradiction and subtlety and ambiguity. And odd things like awe, A-W-E, which used to be a terribly wonderful thing, was a feeling of awe. Now, a feeling of awe is the new iPhone that's got the extra thing that makes the cup of coffee as well. That's kind of where it's been reduced down to. And the idea of being awed by something is very difficult to convey unless you're awed by something. And so many things are possible now. It's very hard to find things to get awed by. The reason why I think the imagination is very important is because when I was growing up, the problem was there was very little choice in your lives. Very little choice into what you owned, where you lived, what was your life was going to consist of. There just wasn't much stuff around. There wasn't much movement. And I kind of thought that I would equate change and freedom, choice and freedom. You know, the more choice you had, the freer you were. And in many ways, that's happened. We have extraordinary choices now in all kinds of directions. And why is it then that we've become more uniform while doing that? That the more choices we have, the more people cling back to a kind of conformity so that this building could be in San Francisco, this building could be in Sydney, this, and the shops downstairs and the television we watch and everything else. It's all very homogenized. And that's great because it reduces tensions and cultural tensions and all the rest of it. But it does mean that we're shy of the individuality of each of us. And the great thing about the imagination is that no two people have the same imagination. Because your imagination is made up of everything that's ever happened to you, everything you've ever seen or felt, every story you've heard, every lie you've told. It's all there and it's unlike everyone else's. So anything that you draw from your imagination is going to be different from anyone else's. And I think that's very important to counterbalance the wonderful accessibility of the uniformity and the popular brands and all the rest of it. Because we're individual, we can look at things in a different kind of way. And I'm going to read a few things to you with your eyes closed. And I was going to start with a longish poem, which you may know. And it's about Christmas, topically. And it's by T.S. Eliot. You may know it. Eyes closed, please, because I want you to imagine what you're listening to. A cold coming we had of it, just the worst time of the year for a journey, and such a long journey, the ways deep and the weather sharp, the very dead of winter, and the camels galled, sore-footed, refractory, lying down in the melting snow. There were times we regretted the summer palaces on slopes, the terraces, and the silken girls bringing sherbet, and the camel men cursing and grumbling and running away and wanting their liquor and women, and the night fires going out and the lack of shelters, and the cities hostile and the towns unfriendly, and the villages dirty and charging high prices. A hard time we had of it. At the end, we preferred to travel all night, sleeping in snatches, with the voices singing in our ears saying that this was all folly. Then at dawn, we came down to a temperate valley, wet below the snow line, smelling of vegetation, with a running stream and a watermill beating the darkness, three trees on the low sky, and an old white horse galloped away in the meadow. Then we came to a tavern with vine leaves over the lintel, six hands at an open door dicing for pieces of silver, and the feet kicking the empty wineskins, and there was no information, so we continued, and arrived at evening, not a moment too soon. Finding the place, it was, you may say, satisfactory. All this was a long time ago, I remember, and I would do it again, but set down this set down. Were we led all that way for birth or death? There was a birth, certainly. We had evidence and no doubt. I had seen birth and death, but had thought they were different. This birth was hard and bitter agony for us, like death, our death. We returned to our palaces, these kingdoms, but no longer at ease here in the old dispensation, with an alien people clutching their gods. I should be glad of another death. That's T.S. Eliot on the Three Magi, the three wise men going to Jesus, going to Christmas. And I think it's a wonderful example of the imagination, because he's taken a scene which is so familiar to us, of the nativity and so on, and looked at it. Imagine what it would be like by the other person who hadn't thought about it, what the kings actually felt coming across, and the discovery at the end of it that what we always look on as the great birth was for them the great death, because things had changed in a way they'd never recover. Spent a Christmas in a place called Westfield, New Jersey, disgracefully with two friends of mine. We got very drunk, and it was a very respectable middle-class suburb in New Jersey. And they had a living crib. And after midnight, we drove up with drink taken, and the donkey was eating baby Jesus. It was another take on Christmas. This business of imagining something is something you can do anywhere, anytime, any place. It is such fun to do, you know, when you put away the tablets and all the rest of it. Anytime you're stuck, just close your eyes and start imagining. Imagine you're someone else. Imagine you're somewhere else in history. I wanted to say a bit about how this has come about by the law of unintended consequences, because no one wanted us to shut away our imaginations. Does anyone know the story of the ostriches and the motor car? So I stumbled across. There was a huge industry in South Africa at the turn of the last century, 1900, which was ostrich farms. And the ostrich farms were kept not for the eggs and not for the meat, but for the feathers, because women in Europe had ostrich feathers. And the motor car came along, and you cannot wear an ostrich feather hat in a motor car. And therefore, the market for ostrich feathers collapsed in about 3 years when cars started becoming... And so the consequence for people who were keeping ostriches in South Africa of someone putting a roof on a motor car was absolutely catastrophic. There's another one to do with Ataturk in Turkey, which is the Turkish leader who, after the First World War, decided to modernize Turkish society. And one of the problems in Turkey was it had an alphabet. Any Turkish people here know the exact figure? How big is the alphabet, the old alphabet in Turkey? There was something like 130 different letters in the alphabet. Right, you're too young. So the result was that most people couldn't read, because learning the alphabet was, I may have got this wrong, but this is how it was told to me by a Turkish friend. Most people couldn't master the art of learning this alphabet. So what Ataturk did was he shortened the alphabet. And the result was that suddenly literacy rates went very, very high, because people could suddenly learn to read. But at the same time, what happened was that most Turkish literature written before that time became inaccessible. Only people who were prepared to go back and learn this now useless alphabet could read it. So on the one hand, you get the progress happening. On the other hand, there are things that fall by the wayside. Concrete is the other one. Concrete's very interesting, and I won't bore on about concrete. But if you think what effect concrete has had on this planet in the last 100 years, it's quite extraordinary. Of how we live, where we live, how we travel, the buildings we live in, and how our concept of how big we can make things. And it's all to do with different ways of pre-stressing the concrete. It's tiny little kind of engineering stuff. Immeasurable consequences. There's a very good book written 15 years ago, 20 years ago, by Neil Postman called Technopoly. Has anyone read Technopoly? I'll read you a little bit from it, because it has in the introduction, which is about this same thing. You will find in Plato's Phaedrus a story about Thamus, the king of a great city of Upper Egypt. For people such as ourselves who aren't inclined to Thoreau's phrase to be tools of our tools, few legends are more instructive than his. The story, as Socrates tells it to his friend Phaedrus, unfolds in the following way. Thamus once entertained the god Theuth, who was the inventor of many things, including number, calculation, geometry, astronomy, and writing. Theuth exhibited his inventions to King Thamus, claiming that they should be made widely known and available to all Egyptians. Socrates continues. Thamus inquired into the use of each of them, and as Theuth went through them, expressed approval or disapproval according as he judged Theuth's claims to be well or ill-founded. It would take too long to go through all that Thamus is reported to have said for and against each of Theuth's inventions. But when it came to writing, Theuth declared, "Here is an accomplishment, my lord the king, which will improve both the wisdom and the memory of the Egyptians. I have discovered a sure receipt for memory and wisdom." To this, Thamus replied, "Theuth, my paragon of inventors, the discovery of an art is not the best judge of the good or harm which will accrue to those who practice it. So it is in this. You, who are the father of writing, have, out of fondness for your offspring, attributed to it quite the opposite of its real function. Those who acquire it will cease to exercise their memory and become forgetful. They will rely on writing to bring things to their remembrance by external signs instead of by their own internal resources. What you have discovered is a receipt for recollection, not for memory. And as for wisdom, your pupils will have the reputation for it without the reality. They will receive a quantity of information without proper instruction, and in consequence be thought very knowledgeable when they are, for the most part, quite ignorant. And because they are filled with a conceit of wisdom instead of real wisdom, they will be a burden to society." It's very interesting, Socrates writing that 3,000 years ago, because you can see now we can find all the information we need somewhere else, so we don't need to retain it inside us. And we think we can get the image, the reason why I'm talking about the imagination, we think we can get the images from somewhere else. We don't need to invent them ourselves. And it's our loss. I'm not saying it's a good thing or a bad thing. I'm just saying it's our loss. And there's a little bit he adds on the end of this. This is Neil Postman. "This is, in short, what Thamus wished the inventor Theuth to see. And it is, in short, an ancient and persistent piece of wisdom, perhaps most simply expressed in the old adage that to a man with a hammer, everything looks like a nail. Without being too literal, may extend the truism, to a man with a pencil, everything looks like a list. To a man with a camera, everything looks like an image. To a man with a computer, everything looks like data. And to a man with a grade sheet, everything looks like a number." And I'm not in any way trying to be negative about all the things now accessible to us, but I'm just saying we forget about the imagination. And I want to go back to the thing about choice because, as you say, I'm an old man. But I grew up in a completely different age. I grew up in a small market town. As I said, we didn't have very much choice. There was a cinema which showed a film once a week. We didn't have television. And everything was in black and white. If we had art books, they were badly printed. And we had a few 78 RPM records. And there were no car radios or CDs. And I bet everyone in this room has got more photographs on their iPhone than their ancestors had in 200 years up until 20 years ago. Our family photo album would have been maybe have 50 photographs in it going back for three generations. So we are surrounded by images now. And there's a great Irish phrase which I love, which is what seldom is wonderful, that you pay attention to things that you don't see very often, and you stop paying attention to things you see a lot of. And there was a lot of claustrophobia living in that kind of society. I'm not being nostalgic about it. There was also a certain serendipity, which is you stumbled across things in the way you can stumble across things in your own head. So, I mean, for example, there were only two television channels then, probably only one television channel. So on an evening's television, you went from one program to another, and the programs weren't all about the same thing. That you might watch a program about gardening, and then the next one was about classical music or about football. And you stumbled across something you didn't think you were interested in because it just happened to be coming up next. Now, I'm absolutely sure if you wanted to find a television channel devoted to bar billiards, you could watch bar billiards all day on television. You don't have that serendipity. And actually, although I use Wikipedia the whole time, and you can do it with Wikipedia, we used to have an Encyclopedia Britannica, which weighed about 5 tons. And when you looked something up, you had to get it down, and you had to get the ST to SU volume. But what you always wound up doing was reading the next door entries. You kept stumbling across stuff. And it's a wonderful thing to do, because you don't finding things that you didn't know you were interested in is one of life's greatest pleasures to me. If you wander into something that you think, I don't like that kind of movie, and then you watch that movie and you find you do, it's a lovely list. The other thing that was true at that time, just as an aside, was that things hadn't been tidied up in the same way as far as the imagination was concerned. There was an abbey in the town I grew up, which dated from Norman times, and it was quite decrepit, and you could crawl around it, and you could become a monk. And you could murder bishops on the high altar and all the rest of it, because it had this great kind of strange atmosphere. You go back there now, it's an interpretive center. And there are boards everywhere telling you in very nice, well-laid-out, illustrated history, you know, the context of this and the context of that. And it's very informative, but it's dull, you know, in the end. You don't get that excitement as I got as a child, thinking, maybe there's a skeleton down there. And there's a lot of that in Ireland now. The OPW tidies places up and puts in the picnic benches and the tea room and puts down gravel. You lose that kind of mystery. What we did with our time was we read books. And the thing about reading books, because we didn't have television, and if the radio was on, we sat and listened to the radio. And you had to have an imagination there, because books and the radio don't tell you everything. You have to do a lot of the work yourself. And the way that you interpret what you're listening to and seeing is different from other people. If you go to a movie or watch a video now, everything's been done for you. You know what everyone looks like. You know what they sound like. They know how they dress. You know what the landscape looks like. And there's even music there to remind you what emotion you're meant to be feeling at that particular time in the film. And it's great, but it's a very passive activity, because you just sit there and you observe what someone else has decided the landscape looks like, what other people have decided how to interpret what's going on. And if you read books, radio actually is great for this too. So we used to listen to the radio in a darkened room. Life was very dull in a lot of ways, but it did train you to use your head as part of the experience of absorbing information. Close your eyes, all of you. Squire Trelawney, Dr. Livesey, and the rest of these gentlemen, having asked me to write down the whole particulars about Treasure Island from the beginning to the end, keeping nothing back but the bearings of the island, and that only because there is still treasure not yet lifted, I take up my pen in the year of grace 1700 and something, and go back to the time when my father kept the Admiral Benbow Inn, and the brown old seaman with the sabre cut first took up his lodging under our roof. I remember him as if it were yesterday, as he came plodding to the inn door, his sea chest following behind him in a hand barrow, a tall, strong, heavy, nut-brown man, his tarry pigtail falling over the shoulder of his soiled blue coat, his hands ragged and scarred with black broken nails, and the sabre cut across one cheek, a dirty, livid white. I remember him looking round the cover and whistling to himself as he did so, and then breaking out into that old sea song that he sang so often afterwards. 15 men on a dead man's chest, yo-ho-ho, and a bottle of rum. Now, that's Robert Louis Stevenson. You can open your eyes. You can wander in, you're having to make up, if you compare that with Pirates of the Caribbean, you see the contrast I'm making. They both do different things well. But it's when you close your eyes and disappear into that world, or listen to that world, or bury yourself in a book, that you start getting there. And we live in a very visual culture now. When I was thinking about doing this, I was remembering I did a terrible bloomer once giving a talk because I'd made some television commercials in Scotland for a bank, and they liked them very much and they thought they were very funny. So they invited me to go over and do the after dinner speech at a meeting of all their Scottish bank managers in the Royal and Ancient Hotel in St Andrews in Fife. And they flew me over and picked me up at the airport and all the rest. And I got up after the dinner, there was 150 bank managers, and I opened my file. And inside I brought the wrong file, and it had the instructions for how to work by chainsaw. And I spoke for 3 minutes and sat down, and it was one of my stomach still churns. But I've got a new chainsaw now, and I picked it up, and the instructions for that haven't got any words in it. It's all drawings. There's a picture of a chainsaw on an arm being severed and all that kind of thing. But because they're selling the chainsaws all over the world, they want to translate it into 30. Everything is done in symbols. And I had a flat in London once which looked down at the back of a Kentucky Fried Chicken, and you could see into the kitchens, not the place where they sold the Kentucky Fried Chicken. In the kitchens, there were these huge posters, and one of them had a picture of a hen, and the next one had a picture of a meat cleaver, and then there was a picture of a meat cleaver cutting the hen in half, because they didn't need language anymore. And you find this everywhere now. You don't have start or stop written. You have arrows and hieroglyphics. And we are bombarded by visual images. And someone told me that the amount of time people spend, and this, so we don't pay attention to, the average amount of time people spend in front of a picture in the Louvre, I think, is 7 seconds. We've seen that, move on, seen that, move on. And it's by looking at a single picture or a single image, again, if you let your imagination run on it, it becomes interesting. If you look at a painting, next time you go to an art gallery, take one picture and spend 15 minutes in front of it. Don't try to analyze it, just look at it. And you'll probably come out at the end of it feeling more enriched, or whatever word you want to use, than you would if you'd actually ticked off the Mona Lisa. You can't get at the Mona Lisa. It's about 15, with people with iPhones taking pictures of people, taking pictures of people of the Mona Lisa. And I will shut up very shortly. I just wanted to say why, as a writer, the imagination is important, apart from the images that you create, because it involves imagining what it's like to be another person. It's the key thing to me to writing, is that you get your heroes, you know, who's actually me, but I'm 29 and I played in an All-Ireland final and I sang with the Rolling Stones and all the rest of it. You get all that shit out the way. But if you try to imagine what it's like, to be Donald Trump. Just think about it. Not what you think of Donald Trump, what Donald Trump thinks of Donald Trump. And don't be judgmental about it. Just try to get inside there. And this is where, this is the real meat for writers. It is also imagining what you try to do as a writer, what you try to do as a painter as well, is you try to look at a familiar view from an unfamiliar standpoint. So you imagine, someone told me when I first went into journalism that what you must always do if you've got a story and there's a villain and a hero, is to turn it on its head and imagine that the hero is the villain and vice versa, and test out that hypothesis rather than walking into it with your prejudices. So imagine that things are not the way they seem to you when you look. And if you're writing, a lot of other things, I mean, politicians could learn this quite usefully, and our opinions could learn this quite usefully. In comedy, it's often a question of taking a situation and imagining something other happening in that, just adding in something. And I don't want to bore you anymore, but I would just say it is in there. There's a fantastic amount in there, and it's fun to play with. And you can play with it anywhere, and it doesn't cost you anything. And you can do it anywhere you want to go. Any questions? Make something happen. Just make something happen. Or you may reach the point where... Are you just playing at this point? Are you being boring trying to write a screenplay? Because I can give you some really, really tedious stuff about writing screenplays. But if you're just imagining, okay, we've got our two tortoises, and one of them says there's a problem. What's the problem?
There's no lettuce left.
No lettuce left, right. Why is there no lettuce left? Keep asking questions. Right. And who owns all those caterpillars? keep asking questions, actually, is the interesting thing. And how does the first tortoise feel about that? And what's the first tortoise's relationship with the second tortoise? Are they in love or are they just broken up? I tell you, you've no idea how much fun these games are. And also, just go free with it. And if you actually want to do something with it in the end, just write it all down and then go back and see what's interesting in it and throw the rest away. As I said, there seems to be a lot of play going on in this building. Is the work done as well?
Just a little.
We were talking about this earlier, and I was saying this definition of a writer is someone who gets up in the morning and comes down and looks at a blank sheet of paper and hopes the phone will ring. I generally, you come across some things in life, something happens, some situation you observe, something you read in a newspaper, which interests you, and you're not quite sure why it interests you. And you do what people call composting. You just kind of sit with that, and at some stage, it'll grow inside you. I wrote a play, which I wrote 20 years after it happened. There was a wonderful thing when the Iranian hostages who were held, the American hostages held in Iran, 1980, I think it was. They were surrounded by the guards, and they were locked up there for a year, and they finally got out. I happened to be in California at that time, and I discovered that all the people who were in the embassy, there's a movie about this now as well.
Argo,
yes, it's about that situation. One guy, they were all diplomats, except for one guy who was a drug dealer, American drug dealer, who was living in Iran running a drug business, and he'd gone into the American embassy to renew his forged passport. And he happened to be caught in there when this happened. So he spent the next year not knowing whether being freed would be the worst thing or the best thing that ever happened to him in his life, because by now they knew who he was. And when everyone flew back to America, there was all tie yellow ribbon and all that stuff, every town in America had to have its own hero to welcome home. San Diego only had the dope dealer. And this guy apparently was on the plane coming into San Diego, still having no idea whether when he got down the steps, the FBI were going to be waiting with the handcuffs, or whether he was going to be garlanded and taken off and given the freedom of the city and all the rest of it. And part of the fact is, I think it's quite a funny story, and it's in a black kind of way. I was really interested in that situation in which what is the best thing or the worst thing that... So I had that idea for a long, long time, and I didn't want to do it literally about the Iran hostages siege. And about 15 years later, I found a way of doing it. So I have these ideas sitting there for a long time, and suddenly they meet up with something else. But if you're writing seriously, the only way to do it is sit down and do it. And if you write nothing good for a day, at least you tried, because otherwise, the house gets repainted 3 times a day, and you drink 8 gallons of coffee, and you write letters to people you haven't seen for 30 years, and boy, do you clean out your address book, and you go back on Facebook for the 10th time in the last 30 minutes, you know. You get down. I used to set a stopwatch. I used to set a stopwatch when I first started writing full-time, and I wouldn't stop work until I'd done 4 hours on the stopwatch. And if I made a cup of coffee, I stopped the stopwatch. I was going to bed at 11 o'clock at night, because you can the temptation not to get down to it. But at least at the end of 11 o'clock at night, I thought, well, I tried. Didn't get anywhere. It's difficult. I mean, to be honest, in the case of Trump, it's very difficult to push the thing further than he pushes it himself. I mean, you use exaggeration a lot in satire. And actually, if I was doing Trump, I'd go the other direction. I'd make him very domesticated and just have him in the kitchen and all that kind of thing. Because if you push, you have to think of another angle to come at it from. And there's also a danger. The kind of satire that is pointless is just saying that Willie O'Dea has got a funny moustache, you know, or that so-and-so has got a stutter. And you get a lot of that. Or Bertie and his anorak, you know, they're meaningless. Whereas if you work out what is actually going on with a character, we used to do on Spitting Image, we used to do the royal family, and it was wonderful because we just had it as a family. You know, it was like the royal family, but it was the Queen and Prince Philip, and they had all this kind of the same domestic problems, and you kind of it changed the way you looked at the real royal family after that because you kept on seeing this happening. It is difficult though now satire because everything's got so well processed. You don't have political parties, you have brands, you know. Can I go now?